What I would like to do today is to, because I think that you're speaking mostly for a biological audience, to talk about the principle of orthogonal nucleic acids. What do we mean with that from the point of view of a chemist? And to try to explain how we analyze things and also how difficult it is to design really something orthogonal that will work in an in vivo situation. Because what we would like to hand at the end is really an orthogonal plasmid or a complete genome or a complete chromosome that's completely different as an information system. That is an artificial information system. And the question is, how do we look at that from a chemical point of view? I do these presentations as well from the our group in KWL Leuven as in Ivry in the ESSB, because we were closing together to reach that goal. Now, why we do that, I think to summarize how we think about synthetic biology, because most things you get, the first question, you do why I do these things, what are the applications? And now, in this whole game of designing new genomes, which we like to introduce in microorganisms, is that what we do metabolically, and then I don't speak only about the genetic system, where we like to change information, but we also like to change metabolism. We also like to change catalytic function. And the application is in therapeutics, energy, food, environment, from or for an evolved microorganism. Of course, when you do something here, when you look after new genetic systems, for example, or new metabolisms, this can be also implemented in vivo directly on therapeutics. And you saw one example of Ishiro, who looked for new information system and applied it directly in synthetic aptamers, which is an in vitro system. So synthetic biology might also deliver you new drugs without going to evolved microorganisms, which is looking from another point of view. Now, how do we look as a chemistry to this field? Most of the people look from synthetic biology from the kind of view of biologist who use natural biology and re-engineer this biology. So what they do, they re-engineer biologicals and they ask themselves questions about circuit designs, bioinformatics, systems biology, standardization, and whatever. Now, if you do chemistry, you look from a chemical point of view on it. We call that indeed, which is already introduced, xenobiology, but we look after synthetic chemicals, evolutionary enzymology, cellular implementation. So I think that the xenobiology is in fact a chemical approach to the biologist and not to re-engineer natural biological systems. So we look in fact at this branch of synthetic biology from a chemical point of view. So this is how it is defined, and Floyd already gave an example of new base pair systems. But we would like to construct cells that would store genetic information in alternative informational polymers consisting of RNA, different base pairs, non-canonical amino acids. You've also heard examples today, alternate genetic code systems, which is generally called by Schmidt as a genetic firewall. Now, we use for that two abbreviations, which were introduced. One abbreviation is this XNA, xenonucleic acids. The other abbreviation is DZA. What's the difference? I will short talk about both today. XNA are completely orthogonal systems. DZA is not really orthogonal in start, but could become orthogonal after an in vivo evolution process. So they are two different ways of looking at the systems. Now, let's first talk about an orthogonal information system, which is an information system that are synthetically and functionally isolated in the cell and do not code potential with the natural nucleic acid. So they do not interfere with the natural nucleic acid. They don't recognize that they have its own genetic system, which do not correspond, which do not talk to the natural system. So it's really a synthetic nucleic acid. It's really a synthetic information system. We do not recognize the natural system. Now, the first thing to think about that orthogonality is that you could think orthogonality in a biological sense or in a chemical sense. If you think about biological orthogonality, which means that your molecule is not recognized in a natural system as a biological entity. It does not show up toxicity, is not conferred to triphosphates. It's a completely entity, which is completely strange to a metabolic, to any kind of metabolism in the cell. When you talk about chemical, and always most of, we'll talk about the chemical orthogonality, is that once you use these monomers to construct alternative nucleic acids, alternative genetic systems, that they do not hybridize with DNA and RNA. That they do not hybridize at all, that they do not recognize, they don't form duplexes at all. They may form duplexes with itself or whatever structure, but not with DNA with RNA. An example is this 2' fluoro nucleic acids, which is neither biological, neither chemical orthogonal. Hexatol nucleic acids is chemical orthogonal, not orthogonal, but it's biological orthogonal. It's quite inert. If you use it in a biological system, you will not see an effect on the monomeric level. They are not phosphorylated. But I put it plus minus because we only test it in a human system, not in a bacterial system. So they might still interfere with a metabolic process. But you are chemical, not inert. If you make an oligonucleotide from that, they will recognize in the cell RNA. And they will block RNA functions. So once they will polymerize into the cell, they will block cellular functions. And then it's not an orthogonal system, because it will interfere in the biological system, not at the level of the metabolism, but at the level of the nucleic acids itself. This is xylonucleic acids, and I explain you why. These are so biological as chemically inert, which makes, of course, evolution a very difficult problem. The second question is, if we go for orthogonal information systems, do we need one or do we need two? Which means the natural systems works with DNA with RNA. If we go for Nixon-A system, an orthogonal information system, do we also need a couple? When I talk about the sugar now, I only talk about sugar modifications. Do we all need the deoxy analog and the ribo analog to have a DNA as well as an RNA mimic, or can we do it with one? It's a question. Now we look structurally at this pair and compare this pair and this pair to try to explain why this is chemical orthogonal to a natural system. So the difference is not big. So one carbon atom will change from conformation, they are epimers. That's the only difference. Now if you speak about chemical orthogonality, then you go to analyze its structure. What happens if you make an information system from these chemical modifications? We go back to the natural system because we look after also a pairing. So me, a deoxy and a ribo analog. This is the classical Watson-Crick systems. You know, the A-type nucleic acids, helical structures, and the B-type, which come back to the structure of the sugar. The sugar conformation determines if you have a B-type and an A-type. A is not flexible. It's RNA only take one structures. DNA can take A and B-type. Mostly it's presented as a B-type because it's a preferential conformation of the sugar. It's a sugar conformation that determines your orthogonality, which means that it determines your structure of your DNA and RNA. It's not a base. So which means that to go to a complete orthogonality, it's easier to work on sugar modifications than on base modifications. So let's look in reality. If we keep this in mind, this helical DNA structures, what happens if we go for deoxy nucleic acid structure. This is a deoxy xylonucleic acid structure. You see, this is a structure which is determined by NMR, and they are not at all helical anymore. This is inside in the minor groove, this is inside the main groove, and they have just a very, very, very small term, and they still have Watson-Crick base pair systems. So you move, in fact, to a nucleic acid structure which is completely different from DNA. They do not hybridize DNA anymore. It's an orthogonal structure. If you go from the ribo, meaning the xylonucleic acid, so with the 2' hydroxy, the RNA mimic, and we took also an NMR structure of that, you see the same. In the minor groove, in the major groove, a little bit twist, but not much. And you see also that the structure is stabilized by interstrand stacking. The stability of a duplex, of a nucleic acid duplex, is determined primarily by interstrand stackings. And this inter-strand stacking, because you see that the base of one strand is stacking above the base of the other strand. And that forms a very stable structure. This is, of course, due to this structure here, because it's not a helical structure anymore. It's quite a straight structure. It's different from DNA from RNA. Now, the easiest way to analyze nucleic acid structures is not go to all the synthesis, go to all the synthesis, but not going to any more of X-ray structure. It's simple to do a CD experiment. Now, if you take this deoxyxylate nucleic acids and you take a CD experiment in water, you see this structure is temperature dependent. Of course, it's default when you increase the temperature and your curve is going down. But this is in water. If you put 100 micromolar sodium chloride on it, you see you have a completely other structure. It's go from that structure to that structure, which means that the deoxyxylate nucleic acids is quite a flexible structure also. Also in DNA, DNA as a helical structure can take BNA type, which is the same here, but it's much more weird. If you analyze the structure here, you see that for the deoxyxylate nucleic acids, they can take this kind of structure. This is DNA structure, the Watson-Crick structure. These are all the different conformations you could have as a conformational cycle. And if you go to a straightforward structure, this is a structure you have with xylonucleic acid. But the deoxyxylonucleic acid can also move in that direction and give a completely left-handed, dependent on the circumstances. But they stay orthogonal. You see the overlap and how easy it is to analyze it by a circular dichromism. You have deoxyxylonucleic acids, you have xylonucleic acid, and here you have ARNA and ZDNA and BDNA. You see, it's completely chemical orthogonal. They don't recognize DNA anymore. They are a system on itself, comparable with the DNA-RNA structure. See that also on the helical parameters, for those who are interested in helical parameters. These helical parameters give you the structures, the twist inclination. Inclination is how far it is inclined to right or left. See here, minus 5, minus 52. The most easy parameter to, you have the right inclination, is the twist value here. Twist value give you how many bases you have in one turn. If you have a turn of DNA 360 degrees, if you have for every base 10 degrees or 36 degrees, you have 10 base pairs in one helical turn. So 36 is what you see here. But if you go to xylo, you have here values of 2.7 and 10. If you have only 2.7 degrees, which means that in one turn, you have 60 base pairs. No, you have 90 base pairs for one turn. So it's completely different structures. And that's what we mean with chemical orthogonality. And that's what, in fact, we are looking for when we want to have orthogonal information systems in vivo. You could say yes, but OK, you put a burden on the generation of the polymerases that want to polymerize nucleic acids, which is quite difficult. We had a collaboration also with Andreas Marx, who looks about the deoxyxylate nucleic acids and several polymerases. And he could show that this deoxyxyloadenine and deoxyxylothymidine, it's not much, but you already could incorporate a couple of this very weird by his polymerases, mutant polymerases, which he has a library from. He could always show that you have two bases which are already introduced. And if you have two bases, you have a start to do an in vitro evolution system to generate the polymerases that go to this, recognize the xylonucleic acids. So to summarize this first third of my talk, that I would say that small changes in the constitution of DNA and RNA, just an epimerization reaction, has a large effect on this 3D structure and can easily lead chemical to a new orthogonal information system. The second part, which I would talk, is a little bit about base pairs. But not about hydrophobic bases, which have been covered, and we never worked on that, but a little bit about the old systems, which have been used and first introduced a long time ago. By Alexander Richen, which have been tested, studied very intensively by Stephen Benner. So this is the iso-C-iso-G base pair. Now normally G base pairs have proton donors and acceptors, and this is the opposite, an acceptor donor donor system. If you go to the iso-C isomethyl base pair, you change this position from a donor to an acceptor, and you also change this position. So it looks like an orthogonal system, but he already showed a long time ago that the problem is that this iso-G system also recognizes T. Yeah, because you can have different tautomeric forms. You see here a ketone function, you see an enol functions. And this, of course, complicated the field, which is already mentioned by Stephen Benner a long time ago, where he put that when he do PCR, these base pair systems show only 96% fidelity in amplifications, which leads to unidirectional loss of information during amplification. So it's not a good base pair system to introduce in an in vivo system. Now the question is the base pair system not good, or is the context in which we use the base pair systems not good? Yeah. So we ask the questions now, if you combine that, if you use now a classical base pair system, it's not so good, but we change the Cordes sugar. Because in an ideal situation, we will not only have in an orthogonal system modified backbone, but we would like to also to have modified sugar, modified base pair systems on the modified backbone. And what happens when you start to combine them? So here you see the iso-C picked it again, and the pair is the iso-C methyl. And here we put a six-membered ring, which we call the HNA, which is in fact on itself. So both as not a base, as the sugar are really completely orthogonal. Now you see already that by doing a simple experiment, the situation already changes. This is the iso-C base pair in an oligonucleotide, and we compare just the problem which you might get in an in vivo situation is that your base system is also recognized by ATGC and that you lose your information. Yeah? So we looked about melting temperature of D-iso-C, exitol-D and exitol-iso-C. So these are the different backbones against ATCG. What we expected, what is already shown before, is that D-iso-C also form mismatches with T. It also pairs with T, less with the other ones. But if we go to an hexital system, it goes to G. So you have a change just by taking a TM on selectivity if you change the backbone. Of course, it also forms base pairs a little bit with A and T, but it's moved, in fact, from T to base pairing with G and with C. So by introducing sugar modifications, you can influence the base pairing. Yeah? If you go by D iso-C, it's recognized by G as a mispair, but if you change it to hexitol, it's also recognized G. Now, the next step was, of course, to see what happens in vivo, okay? And if that correlates with what we see in vitro. Because in vitro, taking a TM is an easy experiment. To see how it behaves in a bacterial environment is a little bit more complicated. This is a test which has been used as a test which has been developed already 20 years ago by Sylvie Posset and Philippe Marlière, which is now used by Valérie Pezzo in the group in ESB in Ivry. So to put it thing simple, in the active site of thymidylate synthetase, the artificial, this is the green one, is a symbol of the artificial sequence. Fine, not the artificial sequence, the artificial nucleic acids, which we introduce here. And this is then transformed, and then she looks if they are thymidylate synthetase positive transformants on a medium without thymidine. So that means when there is growing, you see that the information is red. So this is the same base pair in vivo. You see that the oxy-iso-G is in vivo, in fact, behaving as an A, which recognized by T and in the second place also by G in vivo. The difference is not big. But if you go to hexitol-iso-C, it's in vivo, still recognized by A, although it was more in G in vitro experiment, a little bit in vivo. But you see that the quantity is going much more down. Yeah? So you see that if you combine a modified base and modified sugar, it's almost not recognized anymore. Yeah? So the intensity in which it's recognized is very much reduced. And you see the same with ISO-C. ISO-C is recognized in vivo as a C, but also a little bit as a T. There's not much more difference. But if you put a hexitol on it, you see that the number is going down. You have average ratio, you have not much clones anymore. And if you put two in a row, you don't have information anymore. So in fact, if you only put two hexitols with an ISO-C methyl, it's not recognized anymore in the natural environment. It's not recognized by the bacteria anymore. So a combination of, if you go to different base pairs and different backbones, a combination of them might in fact easily lead to orthogonality. So a combination of modified bases and modified sugars made it easier to orthogonality than you use single modifications, only a sugar or only a base pair. Now we extended this study to some other base pair systems. This is CG and this is ISO-C, ISO-G. Now, a base pair which has been described by Frank Zela, at least in vitro experiments, was ISO-C methyl 8-ASA-G. So we asked the question, could we turn this base pair also to something useful for us? And could we generate here a base pair which where the sugar is connected to the 8 position and the other one is a normal one, but which could recognize each other by Hochstein base pairing? The question is Hochstein base pairing also possible in an in vivo situation, and do we have to account on that? Do we have to think of that problem when generating new artificial systems? So you see that this is a simple model where 8 amino hypoxanthine. Of course, we face here a lot of problems not to understand what we do, and that's why we made also some other analogs. This is the N8 position. This is the 8-aminodeoxyinosine. But it could be theoretically recognized from this side in vivo by a C. That's why we put here a methyl, the 1-methyl over here, which avoids recognition in the Watson-Crick base pair system and only in the Hochstein systems. You have a DDA, donor-donor acceptor, with acceptor and acceptor-acceptor donor. We also made the 8-oxo analog. We turned it to an acceptor-donor-acceptor. We should not form base pairs anymore. So what will happen in vivo? Does it recognize them in vitro? Yeah. And these are also the 8-oxo-diamino, which is the opposite from this one. So this should not be recognized at all. So here you see some of the melting studies. This is the ISO-C 8-ASA-DG base pair. And with the 8-amino, you have 45 degrees, a little bit down. But you see if you put an N-methyl, it's the same. If you put 8-oxo, it's the same. 8-oxo-DG is the same. So they also form base pairs in in vitro situation just by taking the TM. 8-oxo-D anymore. That's two. It's not recognized at all. If you look after the recognition against 8-TGG, the N8-ASA is also recognized IG, so the question is it also so in vivo? What do we see in vivo? The 8-amino is recognized by C. The 8-methyl 8-amino, it's recognized by G even if we block the Watson-Crick port. 8-oxo-DI is recognized by A, in vitro at least, and those is recognized by C and T. So this means if you see this data and you see the previous data, that the problem is in fact, and that was Floyd was mentioned, that when you start to do it from the rational point of view, that the orthogonal base pair design is not always a logical design. Because you have to take care that you can have also wobble base pairs. You have to take care that also the Watson-Crick system is that not only the Watson-Crick system, but the Hochstein systems is recognized. So these are recognizing each other in a wobble base pair system. And also these can be recognized each other, at least in vitro, in a wobble base pair system. So when we look at that in in vivo situation, this is the test which is done. So we look after the incorporation and look if G, C, or T, or A is incorporated. And then the next is sequenced. You see that, in fact, in vitro hybridization studies not correspond always with an in vivo recognition system. And ASADG in vitro behaves as a C, but in vivo behaves as an A. And methyl 8-amino-DI in vitro behaves as a C, but in vivo behaves as a G. Hexetol ISOG in vitro behaved as a CG, but in vivo it behaves as an A. That's what is recognized by the biological system. Which makes, of course, a design just based on in vitro experiments, just YEM studies, very difficult. And even if you look after incorporation studies by polymerase, it's even worse. Because the data you generate, it just depends on the polymerase you use. Sometimes it recognizes A and sometimes G, depending just on the polymerase you select. And it could be indeed that hoxthane base pairing in vivo is probably possible because 8-oxo-DI is recognized by the eye as well in vitro as an in vivo situation. So we analyzed all the system. We don't have an ideal base pair, at least when this is all done with DNA. At least when we look after these base pair systems with the DNA backbone, because the N-methyl-8-amino is still somewhat recognized by C, and the HAZG is still somewhat recognized by T in vivo situation. Yeah. This does not mean, if you would put another sugar on that, that you come indeed to an orthogonal information system. DNA is not a sugar and a base and a backbone, it's all together. And when you look after new information systems, you have to analyze the whole system and not partially the system. Now, the last part of my talk is searching for a new set of four nuclear bases that can be used for faithfully encode information in vivo. This also has to do with how, when we change the four bases in DNA, can that be changed by other four bases in DNA? And still be recognized in a biological system. I don't talk about replication, I just talk about getting recognized and be converted in DNA, getting read by the natural system. Just the first step. Why we do that? Because this is a system which could easily lead to orthogonality if you go the next step to in vivo evolution. You can start by small modification of the natural system and come to orthogonality by evolution or by small chemical changes. Now, if you go back to the literature, some people have analyzed that. If you see this paper on 1957, these people have studied the effect of 5 halogenated uracil on the growth of Escherichia coli and their bacteriophage. And they saw that in the bacteria in the virus, there is replacing of thymidine residues. And they also talk about quantitatively about this 5 oligonated stuff. And they use indeed thymidine, oxotrophic, but in this case by using sulfanilamides. But it means that this 5 halogenated is in fact a system which maybe can also be used by a natural system. But this is a test which has been done a long time ago, but for another purpose, of course, for looking at the toxicity. In another paper in 56, they used Bacillus cereus and 8-azaguanin. And they see that's for 40% incorporated in ribonucleic acid, but only less than 1% in deoxynucleic acid in DNA, which gives already an idea that this might be not a very good system, not very good base in a DNA context, but maybe in an RNA context. So we did a lot of modifications, 5-chloro-U, 7-deaza-A, this is 8-aza, 8-aza, 7-deaza. Some of them were here. We replaced methyl C and 5-fluoro-C and 7-deaza-G and 8-aza-G. And we asked the question, which other four set of nucleobases can be used in vivo situation and transformed to DNA? Now, the setup is, in fact, not so difficult. You synthesize the modified bases. With PCR, you synthesize a gene. This is a gene for dihydrofolate reductase, and then you transform that in vivo, and you see if this gene can still be converted to DNA. It looks obvious, but it's not like that, because you have to PCR multiply, which is with the thermophilic polymerases. Which is a completely other situation as in the in vivo situation where you have mesophilic and other polymerases. It's not because you can do it in PCR. You can do it with PCR a lot because there are a lot of different, and they accept a lot of modifications. But most of the things you do in PCR by multiplying modified nucleic acid, for example, for aptamer design, that do not work in bacteria. It's not because you can make a gene in PCR that it also is recognized by the polymerases from the bacteria, which are mesophilic polymerases and have another substrate specificity. You can maybe do that with small species, but we looked at the whole gene. Now, the first experiment which we do is a simple TM study. This is always the simplest physicochemical experiment you can do. We had a sequence, and we look always at the codon system. The information unit for a chemist is one nucleotide. The information unit for a biologist is a coding system. So we always have to look after three. So we put here three modified. This is A. When you have three A's and three T's, you have TM is 48.5 degrees. You see here, if you start to modify with other bases, with T, it is still OK, 48.2 degrees. But if you go from other pyrimidine bases, you get from 2U, chloru, and ethylU, you see that the stability is going down. Also, certainly with the other base modifications. But the only combination that stands, even in a simple TM experiments, are those with chloruracil, 7-diazaA and N8-7-diazaA. They have the same TM as an AT. So there is something in this kind of molecules, in that chloro, which makes, in fact, the thermodynamic stability the same as the natural base pair. If you look at the C base pair, it's the same. You have G, 7-diazaA, N8-diazaA, C fluoro, C F-methyl, temperature 47.1 degrees. It goes up here with methyl C, but if you go to the fluoro C, 7-diazaA G combination, it's about the same TM as you see, at least in one codon system, as a GC. The other are up, some are down, but most are different. So only with this combination, you have in fact the same thermostability as a codon in a codon system as a natural system. This is the 57 Meyer template PCR with vent polymerases. And you see here that the combination of ANT, 7-diazaA chloru is similar, 8-azaA 5-chloru is less well. So this combination seems not only in the TM, but also when you use it, and this of course together with GNC, quite well accepted in a 57 Meyer template as a modified basis. So if you decide about 7-diazaA 5-chloru as one base pair replacing AT, you can do the combinations of the changes of GNC. And you see these are the number of cycles that go to 40 PCR cycles. And you see here that if you take this combination, still give good results. Also this combination give good results. Also this combination give good results. But this is in a short template. This is the combination of the four bases, but on a 525 base pair amplicon. This is already a large gene. So does it work in PCR amplifications to make a 525 base pair system, amplicon system? You see here that, and these are the different combinations on the different bases, but it's always here 7-diazaA, that looks good. This is with 5-chloru, still okay. Yeah, this is by vent, this is by TAC. And you see here the combination with 7-diazaA G, 8-azaA G. 8-azaA does not work anymore. It works when you make a 60 mer, but once you go to a 500 mer, it's not useful anymore. So it's not because you can incorporate 20, 30, you have a good genomic system. It fails when you go to 500. But it stands still for these combinations of 7-diazaA, 5-chloru. And if you see also that the gene you make is fully stable against restriction, endonucleases, while normal DNA, AGCT DNA, is hydrolyzed by restriction endonucleases. So the next step was indeed to analyze the PCR product from the dihydrofolate reductase gene, which is resistance to trimethoprim. You see here the AGCT, and this is the gene because there's also still AG and C and T in it because we use it in the primers. The first times, now we don't use it anymore, but these are the first experiments. So you could show that the gene is okay, and then it is brought in a vector, which is then transformed, and you look for if this whole dihydrofolate reductase gene is recognized. And you see here the number of clones. We are not going to into the details. These are unmodified DNA. This is with 5-chloro is remarkable. It's in fact the same as a natural system. And even if you combine that with 7-deaza-A, it's still marvelous. And this is, of course, the fully modified. You don't have so many clones anymore, but it still is completely still converted in vivo in DNA enough to survive and to have several clones. I will not go into these are the very few mutations you see there, which gives most of the time even the same amino acids. So there are only few. And this is the growth of the full modified versus the natural, and then versus some negative references. Which means that in vivo, this is the farnucleobase cassette, which is used in the, in fact, there is a mistake here, it should be not a double bond. The AGCT is used by nature. Stephen Benner always called it God's mistake. So it can be at least in DNA to multiply by another DNA. We didn't do replication for the moment. Change with these four bases, which could be another mistake, God's mistake. But at least you can have a gene which is with four different bases. They are all four changed in the natural system. They are still recognized by the natural system. And I have a lot of Copeland slides because of this remarkable molecule, which has been used by Philippe Mallière to evolve to a completely orthogonal biological system in vivo. We did some physical chemical studies in that, how remarkable it is. If you look after the TM again, after one codon system, and this is what I show you, you have the 49.6 degrees, which is similar to the methyl analog, but it's quite remarkable, because if you look after the pK of this molecule, the pK of thymidine is 9.7. The pK of uracil is 9.3. That's why nature used uracil in RNA and thymidine in DNA. It's because of the difference in pK. Now, if you look after the chloride, it's 7.9. So it should be partially ionized in vivo, because then we work at the pK of 9. If you look after the delta pK value, which is the pK value between the purine and the pyrimidine bases, it should be as large as possible to have a stable hydrogen base pair. So in fact, based on this delta pK value, which is the difference between the pK of an acid and a base, and the larger the difference in pK, the stronger your hydrogen bonding, it's very low. So if you do a simple physical chemical thinking, it would never work, despite of that it worked. So we do together with Martin Nagle some X-ray structures to see how the chloride is recognized by an adenine, and here it's recognized by a guanosine, which is by wobble base pairing, so at least an X-ray structure. And you see also mistakes which is made in vivo between chloride and G. But if you look after the same principle, and the principle was already mentioned by and introduced by Eric Hall and mentioned by Floyd here, it has a practical perfect shape complementarity between an AT base pair and 8-chloro-U base pair. If you overlap that, you don't see many differences. And you also see that in the wobble base pair system. This chloroion is hysterically, in fact, the perfect shaping MIP of a methyl group. And that's why it's so interesting to do all this in vivo work, because chloroion is always a substrate in present biochemistry. It's not found in nature. The carbon-chloroine bond is alien to the cell biochemistry. It gives a thermodynamic stable genome. It gives some ambiguous base pairing for evolution. And it respects the principle of shape recognition in biology. And we hope, of course, that with this new four base pair systems, we can continue doing this kind of in vivo evolution process to become an artificial, not only an artificial chromosome, but I think also that this might be the way to an XNA system. Because at least it's recognized by the natural system, and by substituting them and evolving polymerases, you can easily come to an XNA system out of a DZA system, which you still can sequence, because you still have the Watson-Crick port to sequence, which is always the problem when you use in natural base pairs. You don't know what you have because you cannot sequence them. So it could be that in this way we come easily to orthogonality than going to more advanced technologies. I would like to thank these people. We do it together with Philippe, this whole thinking and setting up the experiments. For the in vivo work has been done by Valerie Pezzo and Darren Braddock in Evry. A synthesis is done in Leuven by Om Prakash Bandi, Mikhail Avramov, and Guy Schepers. The whole structure biology work is done in our laboratory by a PhD student, Moitosh Maiti, and the whole work with DZT is also done by a PhD student, which is called Rena Eremeva. And I hope I had convinced you now a little bit more about how we think about orthogonality and how we think, based on chemical orthogonality, can reach sooner or later biological orthogonal systems in vivo. And I thank you for your attention.